heightened danger and ubiquitous threat that journalists confront carries significant psychological challenges. Imagine reporting in midst of gunfire and bomb blast and living to tell the tale of Tiger Hill. That's Rakhi Bakshi for you. One of the few women war correspondents during Kargil. She has been an editor of Rajya Sabha TV and media advisor to Lok Sabha Speaker from 2009 to 2013. Truly, veer se alag. Welcome, Rakhi. Thanks for being here today.
Thank you so much. It's my pure delight and honor to be talking to you, Tejaswini, and talking to a whole lot of people who I'm going to engage with in this interview.
Thank you. Rakhi, my first question to you would be, what inspired you to become a war correspondent? It's such a challenging field.
You know, it's a very interesting question, Tejaswini, and I don't know, I was first in Z. There was something in my DNA that my editors looked at me and always thought that I could always take a challenging task. So I had been doing a lot of such tasks which required, of course, journalism inherently has courage, but also to take a step out and really do something different. So I was always eager. Wo junoon hota hai na, wo tha. And that's how I think editors used to always first look at me and say, oh, are you ready to go? And remember that for Kargil also, I was so eager to go. I said, I have to go and report this. I think it's both how my seniors looked at me, the potential that I had, and also this whole idea of taking journalism to a level where you learn a lot from real life on the spot kind of experience, which was very live as you cover war. So I was very excited, and I'm thankful to my senior there, Z News, who permitted me to go there. And that was quite a unique experience. Seriously, we can actually devote another edition on that, talking about my experiences in Kargil. But truly, I think what I my insights are that, working along with soldiers on the battlefield, you learned a lot. You almost felt like a soldier, working in conditions which are not so supportive at times in terms of infrastructure, logistics and all that. And that's where you really remember that this is real reporting. And I'm really, really today grateful that in my career, I've done that.
Right. What do you think?
If you're looking for...
What do you think are the emotional strengths that are required, to become a war journalist?
So I think first of all, Tejaswini, and I would talk here as a senior also in the industry or profession, that first of all, you should have research on the subject. Of course, it's very important. You should understand that if you're trying to report war, you should know what's happening globally, what's happening in that particular region, country, all that. So that study is important. The right kind of detailing in terms of what you're going to do, what are those parameters. So one thing very important here is, for example, if you're going to be a war correspondent, is to, there are defense courses, orientation courses. Even if you haven't done that, go through those guidelines, because there are a lot of do's and don'ts. You're talking about the strategic part, the defense part of any region, country, where you're reporting, especially war reporting. So you must know those do's and don'ts, and you must be very careful, because it's related to security. The other thing, of course, is that you should have that courage and zeal. So, for example, you really have to be fearless. You really have to have belief in you that what you're going to do is what you really believe in. Also, truth matters. So you have to look at all the sides, the versions, and really report unbiased. Because, if you see globally, when I also covered Iraq war, apart from Kargil, we were in a global space. So that was another experience which was in Doordarshan. So and it only happened because I'd already covered Kargil, and my director general, Mr. Qureshi, that time thought that I should be the one to cover war. And I really felt I was fortunate from Doordarshan to go. I think the first time a lady went to report on war that time. And that was another experience. So talking about how to become a war correspondent, these are the things. also the nuances. You have to also be human, because there would come dilemmas for a war correspondent as to what you're seeing, what you're being shown, and what you should report on. So be very clear about those fine nuances,
right,
as to what the truth exactly is and how you should present that truth.
Right.
So that, of course, yeah. And when I say courage also means that we were hungry almost for so many days. I mean, eating almost chocolates or anything that we got. So you should be ready for any eventuality. So, I mean, I think from physically, emotionally, you go through a lot of churning when you report war. So you should be, it transforms you as an individual. So I think you should be ready to take on new challenges and also be human at the same time.
What you said is really important, because when we watch television at home and when we see war being covered, it impacts us a lot. So what is shown and how to show it, when to show it, all those things, and I'm sure they matter a lot. Could you tell us an incident that happened there on the ground?
You know, I think narrated many actually. So, for example, Kargil, yes, when I landed, I remember in a bus, it was dark in the evening. I went to the Siachen Hotel, which is very popular in Kargil. And when I landed, there were 35 other male journalists waiting for me. I was the only female that time. Of course, there was another one who had left. And so here I go. And we decided that, so we used to go in groups at times. We really coordinated well, and I said, okay, now 35 of you are here, males, and I'm the only female. So maybe what I can do is I wake you up early in the morning to go to your assignment and maybe order whatever it was, the hotel. There were less resources to organize tea for you. So, and we all reported in her, you know, as a team. And it was quite an experience. In the evening, we would come back and, somebody would narrate a shayari or somebody would sing. And that's how we would relieve ourselves for a few minutes. But talking about Iraq experience, let me tell you that it was a very important experience where a lady, a senior citizen who had lost everything in the war, her house was devastated. It had gone in the blast. When I went to report there and was covering the debris, so to say, and then I took a bite from her as to, you know, how the condition was. And she, when I was coming back, she said, in her own language and broken Hindi English, she said, why don't you wait? I have to offer you one big roti or chapati, because you must be hungry. You've been reporting since morning. And I realized, look humanity here, that globally humanity exists and like this. You know, when you have nothing and you offer something, I think that's the biggest reward of humanity that I saw there. I can never forget that moment.
Beautiful. And the fact that you are able to recall this incident in midst of war and all the gory that must be happening around there, it says it all. And what is interesting is, apart from war, you have also done not many other things. So how challenging was it? I'm sure it was interesting and challenging being media advisor to Lok Sabha speaker.
Even that, they just really came by chance. You know, I was in Doordarshan and I was covering parliament, and I was a very regular parliament correspondent. And when the speaker, Honorable Meera Kumarji, that time joined, this idea came in that I should join her. I never thought about it. I was very pretty much into my own reporting and taking a round of that big parliament building, and how much I miss it, because it kept us physically active and got so much news and tidbits there. It's a very interesting place, I must tell you. So much is happening there. To take on another role where I was looking at media and managing, because I was media advisor, was quite challenging. I mean, I can tell you that right at 11 a.m. when question hour begins, I would be sitting in the speaker's gallery to take care of the strength of parliamentarians, what they're doing, how the proceedings are going, what the speaker would need in terms of information in the morning. So number of newspaper that you scan right at 6-7 in the morning and then know what's happening. Know any political stuff which is happening internationally, nationally, regionally. So I think collation of many things, where you collate news, information, understanding of legislative proceedings, I learned a lot. I mean, That's where you learn, because laws are being made. You learn as to what goes behind that. I mean, also how parliament actually functions, also how democracy actually really, really functions there. In various delegations that we went to abroad also, one really learned what is India's strength. I mean, for example, our parliament, which is parliamentary democracy here in India, we really promote that unique voice of consensus. So to learn all that, and I can tell you very proud moments when Barack Obama came, and I was so closely, I watched and handled media there, when Myanmar's leader Aung San Suu Kyi came, then also one handled things. So many world leaders came, you got to see them, you know, closely, also handle communication and media, and the whole political spectrum that you saw very closely. I think it kept on my toes. I don't know how those 4 or 5 years went by. I mean, I was literally on my toes.
It must have been beautiful. Also a different ballgame altogether, from war journalism to being in the midst of political theater, so as to say, where all the laws are made and where image of India is handled in front of foreign dignitaries. Awesome.
Exactly.
You know, coming from you, it would be great to know, do you think our journalism courses prepare students for real life challenges?
So I
think
No, but right now, Tejaswini, as we speak, we are seeing a lot. I mean, you talked about the word theater and I like it. And I think right now, I would sadly, for many of us who have been in active media, it's a moment of reflection, I think, as to what's happening today. And I think we are going through some churning, and I think something better has to come out from what's happening today. So but I remember having also been lecturing in various media colleges, universities and institutions, is that it has to really, first of all, understand that media is considered to be the fourth estate. So the kind of power we have, but how do we use that power is very important. The power of responsible journalism, the power of truth, the power of good research, facts, figures that we stick and stand by, and which should only be the basis of how we take a report ahead, you know, unbiased approach, all those things are very, very important. So I think journalism institutions have to really believe in that, how to impart those values and ethics, apart from those syllabi, which teaches you the practical sessions and different aspects of media or journalism. I think these values are very, very important.
Even the syllabus, I mean, because I teach journalism at various media colleges, the social media aspect is really, I think, not taken care of as much as it should have been in syllabus. It is yet to catch up with the major changes that have been happening in journalism.
That's a very pertinent point you're saying. And if you see, I'll tell you very frankly that I have started not watching TV so much these days. And most of my news I'm getting from social media, from Twitter, so to say. Some of the breaking news comes there first, you know. So social media has become a very important part. If you know that, you must be knowing this, that how TV channels they all have their own digital wing now.
Absolutely.
And they have their, they have their YouTube wing, digital media wing. So digital media has taken on. Many a times you've seen that from social media, active news channels and newspapers are taking news from and creating a bigger article or piece out of that. So I think social media is very important. Of course, I must say there is a caveat that social media has to be, again, used very carefully. You know, it spreads and spreads how we know that. So let's also use it very double-edged. So we have to use it very wisely, but very important, very significant. It's like this real weapon, I think, for journalism. Also, it's a great tool.
What advice would you give parents and young people who want to become a journalist, and war and political journalist in particular?
So these are two areas. And I believe that you should have specializations also. For political journalism, of course, you have to, be an avid political science reader, understanding of politics, the system, especially the country region that you are in, those nuances. For example, if you're doing it in India, our country, then, I mean, India is a diverse kind of country with unique aspects and so many layers, here, which is very interesting to cover. I can tell you that so many foreign journalist friends used to come and used to say, oh, covering elections in India is the most fascinating thing. You get to learn so much. You get to learn so much. And with due regards to election commission and with all the codes today, I remember also reporting at a time when you had those beautiful banners, posters, those horns, remember, those rickshaws and all saying, speaking for the candidates, the kind of sound that election presented, the color that election presented, and various other things. I think covering elections for me has been a fascinating thing. So students who are listening, I think first of all, I would advise you again to study well. Your research is your real pillar. Don't ever forget that. I mean, behind all the glamour when you're seen on the screen and reporting, I think for TV especially, it's very important that you should know what you're saying. So you should have a good background research. You should follow your news very well. So read newspapers, very important. Get to know people, interact with them, and you should have an understanding. Of course, incisive questions based on, again, facts, figures are very important. And how you stick to your truth. Because I think many times journalists also, in political journalism, they have all kinds of pressures at times. So I think how do you maintain your own ethical standards within those pressure is very, very important. And I think you should have that belief in yourself as to conviction, as to what I have read and what I'm going to present is something that I believe in. I think that's very important. As far as war correspondent, being a war correspondent is concerned, previously, I think to all the students out there, I would say yes, ye bahut himmat ka kaam hai, aap zarur lijiye isko, but yes, only if you have a tough heart, so to say, because you really face a lot of challenges. At times you will not get food for days, at times you will not go get any resource. I remember suddenly I saw in my car that the car's tire was going somewhere else, it would have just been, I don't know where. So things can just happen all of a sudden. It can just create surprises. So being a war correspondent, you have to have, again, those things that I spoke about, that your background work, understanding of the region, the whole permutation combination at the geopolitical kind of platform that you understand.
Research is probably the crux of it. Research, courage and sticking to your conviction. Maybe to
conviction. Yes, you rightly said it. I think these three qualities primarily. If you see and that go getting kind of attitude that okay, come what may, I'm going to get to the truth.
Right.
So sticking to that kind of I would even say a madness to get to the truth. that makes you a perfect journalist. We are called crazy, I think that's also
yes. Among many other things that you have done. You have broken the glass ceiling and paved way for people or young girls in particular in fields that are dominated largely by men. Thanks a lot, Rakhi, for being here and giving us insight into the world of journalism, war and political journalism both. Thank you.
Thank you so much. It was my pleasure to talk to you.